Hey, are you ready for a new sketching challenge? Are you going to do Inktober? I admit I never managed to do it, but this year I'm in!
Yeah, yoohoo! Me too!
And I have this project about using several techniques together, so I thought I would share with you my 5 techniques for Inktober. I will demonstrate each technique along with sharing my advices to get it right and also my material recommendations. Before we get into it, if you don't know Inktober, just in a few words, that's in October, a kind of a drawing challenge. So the idea is trying to draw every day during 31 days during the month of October, especially with ink, but you can also use other techniques along with the ink and also pencil first if you like, digital drawing. That's kind of a free challenge. I will put some links with all the explanation in the description box below, so if you want to check them to be sure what Inktober is about and what you can do or not do, but just for the pleasure of drawing this month, especially with ink. Let's talk about some techniques that can help us to be more creative and to complete the challenge this year. So the first of the 5 techniques I want to share with you is not so original, it's called drawing.
wait, does that mean that the 4 other techniques are not really drawing?
Haha, yeah, you'll see.
That's intriguing.
But first, I have a few things to say about drawing. I tend to use waterproof materials to be sure not to make a mess when I add, usually watercolor or something. And my favorite supplies to draw with ink are this Fudenib fountain pen. I made a whole video about it called my favorite pen for drawing. You can check the link just in here. By the way, if you don't know, you don't have to click right away on these links. So feel free to watch this whole video, and if one of these links got you interested and you didn't watch the video already, you can just click on the little eye at the end of the video and you will have all the suggested video displayed. So this is how it works. I didn't really got it at first, so that's why I am sharing with you this kind of practical information. But let's get back to the drawing, and this fountain pen is just amazing because it allows you to create some thinner line and thicker line and getting thickness variation, but with a steady tool, not like a brush when you are a bit your hand is floating in the air. So feel free to check the other video if you want to know more about this fountain pen. And by the way, there is also another video about the ink I am using with it. But for sure, you will see me drawing with this a lot during the Inktober challenge. The other pen I like is Pilot V-Ball. It's kind of a random pen you can buy in your supermarket. And it's not supposed to be waterproof, but the ink doesn't smudge, so that's a real plus. And when I just want to get some fine lines without any thickness variations, or we are going to talk about cross-hatching or this kind of thing, this is really handy as well. So about the drawing technique, I would really recommend that you doesn't only stick on your usual technique, but you can also explore other techniques, because there are so many things we can do just only with a pen. You know, you can use continuous line to simplify your drawing, you can use cross-hatching for shading. So yeah, feel free to get creative already just with this.
So let's say that I want to sketch a tree just with my Fudenib, so I know that I can get thicker lines and thin lines, and playing with the tools to get the impression of the subject, even if this is a bit childish. It will probably get better with my other techniques. You can use a bit of shading, to get some dark value, especially at the bottom of the subject. It's always nice to have a kind of shadow sense at the bottom of the subject, and at the top you have more the light this direction. Think about not attaching all your lines, but sometimes just breaking the lines, which gives kind of a nice look. And on the contrary, sometimes, as I said earlier, just working with a continuous line without moving your pen can give you sometimes a really funny approach. This is not the best subject to do so, but I guess you get the idea. And with a fine liner, of course, you can get a more refined, fine drawing, and you can use cross-hatching to get a bit of a shading effect too, which give you a totally different look. So yeah, this first point is to say that already just with drawing, of course, you have so many options that it's interesting to explore. I like how the kind of cross-hatching dynamic lines give the impression a bit of, I don't know, wind in my kind of childlike tree.
Dust in the wind, all they are is dust in the wind.
introducing the technique more or less from the most common to the most original. And technique number two is using water-soluble ink. And as we're going to see, you can use it all alone by itself or along with waterproof ink and playing with waterproof, water-soluble to get the effect you want and you like.
So when using water-soluble ink, you usually draw first with a tool or a fountain pen that has water-soluble ink in it. It's the case that this one. By the way, I recommend that you test your pen, especially on the paper you are going to use, because sometimes you can have some kind of surprises. For example, when I made a test yesterday on cartridge paper of some of my pen, especially this one, which is called Pilot Parallel Pen, I was really surprised that it was, you know, smudging just a little bit, so it was not waterproof, not good for waterproof drawing, but it didn't seem good to have a nice, you know, water-soluble effect. But when I tried it again this morning on the paper I am using for the sketchbook, which is a Clairefontaine 160, it's smudging really much more than in here. So I know I'm going to be able to use the effect. Can change depending on the paper, so nice to try it. And now that I sketched the tree with the water-soluble ink, I'm going to use a water brush to smudge it and to create some effects. So the goal is to get a bit of shading, so once again, more kind of wetting the paper at the bottom. If your water brush is dirty and you want kind of clean it, you can use a towel or a piece of paper and squeeze the water brush to clean it. That way you can sometimes get kind of, you know, variegated edges with just water at the top and a bit of a smudging ink at the bottom. To get a bit of a negative painting effect with a clean brush, it can be interesting sometimes to touch the outside of the line, so that the top of your subject in the light is going to stand out on a slightly grayer background.
I'd rather be a forest than a street. Yes, I would if I could.
As I said earlier, you can use your water-soluble pen alone, or you could use a waterproof tool like my Fudenib to make a kind of drawing, and afterwards using also a water-soluble ink to get some shading. That way you are sure that the line you created with your waterproof pen are not going to move, are not going to smudge, you are not going to lose your drawing, but you can benefit from the nice effects from the water-soluble ink. Now I add a bit of water-soluble something, maybe just to make a bit of shading, so just putting a bit of the ink and then using this to smudge it. But once again, if I put some water on my other lines, of course they are not going to move because they were made with a waterproof tool, so this can be an interesting technique to use too.
Technique in the technique that I use quite often is not using really a water-soluble ink, but keeping this idea of putting water just after drawing to get some shading by not waiting that the waterproof ink would dry.
So this time I am using my waterproof ink to make a kind of drawing, but because it's not dried yet, I can also play with the water to get some interesting effects. The advantage of this technique is you don't have to use two different pens, you have a bit less tool, only the water brush and the waterproof pen. Probably to do this you need a juicy tool like the fountain pen I am using, and you can also see that the effect is different. I get this depend of the ink you use, but the waterproof ink gives me a really neutral gray, whereas the waterproof ink tends to separate between blue and yellowish tones.
Now let's get to the third technique to have even more fun. Remember in the previous technique we drew and then adding water? The third technique is wetting the paper and draw or paint with ink on wet paper. Wet in wet, gorgeousness! The best way to do this is using India ink. I really recommend that you get a pot with the eyedropper like this one, because this is so handy that you don't need the brush if you just want to use the pure indiluted ink. By the way, I will put some links about the materials in the description box too, so if you want to check the pens, the ink, everything, just feel free to check the links to get my recommendation about my favorite ink too.
So this time the idea is wetting the paper first, so you can use a real brush, and if you use a water brush, I recommend that you put really a lot of water. You can squeeze a bit the water brush to get a nice puddle of water, and then you are going to drop a bit of an ink drop. Look at that, I love it. As you can tell with this indiluted drop of India ink, which is so powerful, the tree is really dark. If you want to have a lighter effect, a bit like in here, you have to dilute the India ink with a bit of water and use it with a brush. This is not the best effect I ever created, maybe because of the paper. I have to make some more tests. The thing I like to do when I want to have just a more subtle effect, I'm going to wet the paper and create a kind of a mark, like more background effect, and kind of maybe not as dark, and in here. And with an old brush, I pick a bit of India ink on the eyedropper or in the pot. Then I drop it a bit in the water. And now I am able to make a kind of a more diluted mark. Look at that, it's so fun. Of course I can keep working on it if I dip again in the ink and then drop some ink pigment again a bit more in some places. Hey, look what it did at the edge of the water pot. I never saw this. Look how fascinating this is. See, here the ink is creating a bit more effect than that previously, with a bit of water creeping in the pigment. I guess I will link also the video about the great effects on white paper. Now, of course, if I want these to look like trees, I have to add a bit of trunks in here. Here we are! Some more trees. Oh, what kind of trees? Look how we can be creative just with ink. But with this third method about drawing on wet paper, there is another way to do it, which is maybe not as powerful as India ink, but which is really more convenient. And this is about wetting your paper and then using a fondant pen, especially with waterproof ink in it, to create smudgy lines.
So clever! So many ideas!
I'm wetting my paper once again, and so the waterproof ink in the fountain pen is not as powerful as the India ink, so it can seem dark at first. Oops, sorry. But then it's going to end up paler, but this is really fun also to create marks like this on wet paper. It can be just slightly damp, more wet, really like a puddle, like I did in here. As it's drying, you can reinforce some lines, and maybe you notice that when I remove the pen from the paper, it creates an area with more ink. So if you don't want to have this, for example, at the top of your branches, that's better to draw them from the top and then at the bottom to get the darker part at the bottom. With this fountain pen, I can using it upside down too, to create, you know, more precise marks and finer lines. This is a wild old tree. This is different from the previous technique in several ways, but especially when you draw with a fountain pen on wet paper, you are going to create a kind of crease in the paper, so you won't have a kind of a smooth area like that. So that's a bit different.
Holy tree is growing. Joy, the holy branch start.
Now that the drawing is drying, you can see a bit more the crease in the paper I was talking about, that you really see a bit of the line you drew, and along with a kind of a smudgy ink all around. And once again, you can keep working on it while the paper is wet or even afterwards. If you want the drawing darker, you have to draw several times in the same areas.
If you are inspired by this technique about using ink on a wet paper, I really recommend that you check the work by Andre Peniovac. He's drawing especially cats, but also sometimes a subject like hen or recently pandas, and that's so amazing what he's doing with the ink on a wet paper. I don't recommend that you try to do this for the challenge because it involves a lot of technique, even if maybe it can seem simple, just a kind of a ball of created with ink, but this is so amazing to discover and inspiring, so please check it out. Link, link, link. Fourth technique is something I started to use more a bit lately, and for a few weeks I was thinking I would try to include this ink technique with my other drawing technique and create something special by associating all the things together, and it's about using stamps. Yeah, because stamps is an ink technique. Of course, this is a drawing challenge, so you are not going probably to use just a stamp all alone and say that you draw a butterfly or bugs scrolling on the page. But stamps are not only because you don't want to draw something, they really bring something different in the texture, in the rendering, you know, this kind of stamping effect. Plus, a lot of subjects are not the same if you draw them even realistically and with a stamp. The first subject for which I realized I would really definitely need a stamp is Earth, is a kind of map like that. Of course, sometimes you can try to draw a bit of the coast of a country or something, but once again, it won't give you such a precise result. Plus, this is really small and you can include it in your journal just in 5 seconds, so that's really handy. Plus, one of my favorite stamp too, as just kind of a postage stamping thing, and this is not going to be the kind of thing you are drawing in your sketchbook either, but I think they can really be a fun addition to the sketchbook. Along with the stamps, I am using this Stazon ink. It's a waterproof ink, really strong ink you can even use on various surfaces, and this is nice to use waterproof ink because no matter the order, if I sketch first or put a stamp and then putting water to get some water soluble or wet in wet effects, I know that my stamp is not going to smudge, so this is really handy. The only thing is when you use it with the acrylic stamp and the acrylic block, it gets your acrylic block really dirty, so I know I want to buy another one so that it doesn't look so dirty in my video. Sorry for the dirtiness, but that's a bit of the real life and the real thing of the artist's life. Dirty acrylic block. And I also think about using them just simply for texture sometimes, you know, rather than using some shading with cross hatching or wet in wet ink, just stamping the areas when I want my drawing to be darker can be a nice thing to do. I am really pumped about experimenting with this. By the way, I was wondering about making a video about how to use acrylic stamps and also making kind of a stamp haul when I would share the stamp I like to use and provide links in the case you would like to buy a kind of similar stamp. So please tell me if you are interested about it. So this is purely an experiment, but about the idea of using the stamp maybe more in an abstract way and for texture, I'm going to try to use this stamp, which is a kind of a Brooklyn special stone. For example, why not trying to use this to make a tree? So of course I can use them that way. My tree could be really straight, but you know, using it several times, you can create other kind of effects. If you don't want things to be so straight sometimes, or to have the whole stump, you can using a bit of a mask. For example, I put just a random piece of paper in here, and now if I stamp something, of course the stamp is going to stop in here. Plus, if you tear your piece of paper kind of with a curvy shape, this is going to work for your drawing. For example, here if I wanted to keep going with my tree, I could mask it with this curvy piece of paper. And maybe this stump would be a bit too big to make a kind of a branch, so why not trying this airmail thing? And the right way to ink stamps normally, I don't always do this, but it is putting the stamp pad at the top of the stamp and at the reverse. And now, not easy to do this in one hand, but I would stamp this in here and I would have only a part of the stamp in here, creating some branch. Thank you.
kind of stumps and shapes, I would obtain other kind of results. And I guess it would look really childlike, but just so that you get the idea that, you know, with a kind of a round shape like that, you could use it at the base to draw a lovely sunshine or something. Not sure how I want to draw my sunshine. Or maybe it can be a kind of special monster that is going to invade the universe. So once again, it's not a good drawing, but just for the tutorial and showing to you that maybe I envision to try to use stumps for fun things, texture, shapes, and that it can be interesting for you to try as well. And look, I even found some Alice Adventures in Wonderland stump. This is so funny. And there is in here the white rabbit. And so for this October, I decided to use the rabbit to kind of sign my entries. So I guess it's going to be really fun.
Yeah, I'm on the sketchbook! I am so excited about it!
It weighs in stone. My instinct tells me I should walk this path alone.
Let me suggest two other kind of related approach to this stamping technique about using kind of a material that you bring in your work or using more something for texture than for depicting a subject. One would be to use a bit of a collage. For example, yesterday I printed some music sheets and I was thinking that included a few notes here and there could be a nice ink addition too. And then this morning I thought, oh, but maybe some kind of patterns, kind of a Zentangle inspired, can be nice to use in the drawing, you know, rather than making some cross-hatching or something for shading, you would use other kind of patterns. And this could be a really, really creative approach too for our upcoming sketches.
Even just cutting a few words in a magazine can be nice. I would probably keep it black and white. For example, I like that here it's a white letter on black background, but just cutting a bit of text and using some collage too seems kind of an interesting idea.
So I hope this is going to inspire you. The fifth technique probably is going to surprise you as well. Haha, you said five techniques, but I think I at least counted the eight already. But please tell us which is the supposedly fifth one. The fifth technique is lettering. And I read a quote just yesterday which says lettering, it's all about drawing letters rather than writing them. And I think it's just a perfect way to express why I want to include them in this technique selection and use them in my drawing. I think writing can really have a nice visual aspect. It can help to go a bit from the sketchbook feeling to kind of a journal, travel journal feeling. And even if you don't like your handwriting and you think you can't really write really well, I would really recommend that you use it nevertheless, because even scribbling letters can be really interesting. Once again, you can use them more for texture than for a readable text to get. So of course it can be kind of a big lettering like calligraphy, but it could also be a kind of a few little notes like I added as well on my page today and also in my previous video about the value thumbnail and urban sketch studies. By the way, I am thrilled that you enjoyed so much this video, because I enjoyed so much to make this kind of a vloggy tutorial video too, and I hope to make some more in the future. So thank you so much for your feedback. But about the thumbnail, maybe you remember the last one I did really loose. There were some kind of notes here and there with arrows, and I really like this kind of sketchy feeling. So you can use lettering for refinement if you are able to make a lovely calligraphy. One day I will make some videos about calligraphy. And you can also use it for texture and from kind of a journal scribbly approach, which is really nice. So here are the pens I particularly like to make some calligraphy, especially because they add a difference of thickness in the letters. In fact, these two ones are water soluble, so I really need to be careful about them, but this one is waterproof, so this is a plus for you, my dear.
So there are two sorts of lettering, one for which you use this kind of a thick nib. So this is Pilot Parallel Pen. They are really nice tools and you can have them with a really wide nibs, and you know, you have several widths of nib. And this is a kind of pen you use a bit more like for gothic calligraphy or something like that.
I realized realized just a few weeks, a few months ago that you don't really need to have a deep pen to make a modern calligraphy, but that these kind of markers are just gold.
This is a Pentel touch pen, and this one is called Fudenosuke. I am not sure I remember about the brand. I'm going to use this one because it's waterproof, and these pens seem quite normal when you look at them like that. But in fact, they are quite special in their way of working, because you can make really fine line, and then you can bend the nib quite a lot, and they are really meant to be used that way, and this allows you to make this kind of calligraphy with difference of thickness. You know, especially trying to keep them thin for the upstrokes and then making them broader for the downstrokes. Thin, broad, thin, thick, thin, thick, thin, thick.
So try, as the quote says, to draw letters, to play with their shapes, to include them in your drawing if you like. And this can be a nice ink addition to your work too, for Inktober or anytime.
Like endless rain into a paper cup, they slither wildly as they slip away across the universe.
Of course, think about not using only one technique at a time, but mixing them together for more creativity. It's always a good thing to spice things up, because to keep going on our sketching practice or to try to take on a 31 days of challenge, you don't want to get bored. So trying to add new techniques and new tools and new approaches is always the best thing to do. Feel free to subscribe to join the creative side of the force if you haven't already. Share this video to your friend if you think they could benefit from the content and be even more inspired for Inktober or anytime, and see you really soon.